loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Let's do 57.
That's Babylon.
number 8.
Sure.
to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives, but greater still the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days, because he lives, because he lives. I can face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone because I because he lives. And then one day I'll cross the river, I'll find life's final war with pain, and then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know he lives, because he lives. I can face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone because I
again, good morning. It's good to see you. Turn your Bible to Acts chapter 4. Acts chapter 4. Again, reading in verse 1. We're going to continue our study of the book of Acts. We've been doing it on Sunday mornings. And Peter has concluded his sermon. You know, this all was a result of him through the power of God, through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, enabling someone who was paralyzed to be able to walk. That caused quite a stir. It drew a lot of attention. And Peter seized upon that opportunity to do what? Tell those people about Jesus. Because that's what it's all about, isn't it? He was quick to do what? Direct all glory, all honor, all praise toward who? Jesus. He gives him the credit, does he not? As we should in all that we do in our lives as well. Whatever it may be. Even maybe something you say, well, I've never been able to do anything on that kind of scale, that kind of, you know, magnitude. But little things you do in life for other people, be sure, be careful to do what? Give Jesus the credit. Give Jesus the glory for it. And that's what he did. And as a result of that, we're going to see and talk about this morning the response that he got. And understand this. Not everybody is going to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. Many are enemies of the cross. They're going to try to extinguish that light that emanates, the light of God, the light of Jesus, that emanates from believers, and try to discredit us, try to silence us. That's what we're up against. We know that. But there are those that will believe, will trust in Jesus, will be saved. And we're going to look at that this morning and talk about that as we read through this scripture. But the main thing I want to focus on this morning is on verse 13, and we'll get to that in just a few moments, but I want to briefly mention the fact that, look, I want to talk this morning about boldness, confidence. Now, many people don't think that you can be confident and still remain humble, but I disagree with that. I think you can be humble and still be confident. And we're going to talk about that this morning. Many people see confidence as being arrogant, cocky, so to speak. Well, that depends upon who your confidence is in. We're to be confident in Jesus Christ and what He can do and what He's doing in our life. And we need to be bold in proclaiming that and telling others about that. And we'll talk more about that in just a few moments, about being bold, being confident. Verse 1, as they spake unto the people, the priest and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon him. Now keep in mind, the Sadducees did not believe in a literal resurrection. Being grieved, that they were taught the people and preached through Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they laid hands on them and put them in hold until the next day, for it was now eventide. Howbeit, many of them which heard the word believed, and the number of the men was about 5,000. See, when you preach Jesus, God's word does not return to Him void. It accomplishes what He sends out for it to do. So, if we preach Jesus, and Christ said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. You see, that is the primary function of the body of believers, the church, is to do what? Preach Jesus. Lift up Jesus. Exalt Jesus. Because we're going to see here in just a few moments, there's no other name given among men that you can be saved except through who? Jesus. We continue reading on. It says in verse 5, and it came to pass on the morrow that their rulers and elders and scribes and Annas, the high priest, and Caiaphas, and John, and Alexander, and as many as were of the kindred of the high priest were gathered together at Jerusalem. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked, by what power or by what name have ye done this? Peter immediately directs the attention toward who? Jesus Christ. Peter wasn't trying to make a name for himself. He wasn't trying to be famous. He was simply trying to exalt Jesus with his life and fulfill God's calling for his life and what God wanted him to do. We'll talk more about that in just a moment as well. But anyway, it says in verse 8, then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, you rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man, by what means he is made whole, be it known to you all and to all the people of Israel that the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone which was set at naught of the builders, which has become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other. For there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. You see, he seized upon this opportunity to do what? Preach Jesus. Exalt Jesus. Lift up Jesus. It says in verse 13, now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled, and they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. And beholding the man which was healed standing with them, they could say nothing against it. Now, I want to talk this morning about boldness, confidence, being fearless, so to speak. And with confidence does come fearlessness, doesn't it? Someone who is fearful is not confident, are they? They're not willing to do what? Do what they need to do. They're not willing to take that chance, so to speak, because for some reason, whatever it may be, they have a lack of confidence. But I think that is because it's misplaced. It's misplaced. Every born-again believer should be confident and bold in doing what? Lifting up and doing what God would have them to do. But we're going to talk more about it. Oftentimes, people look at themselves and begin to make excuses as to why they can't stand for the Lord, why they won't stand for the Lord, why they can't do what God called them to do. But if they get their eyes off themselves and put their eyes on Jesus, they would realize, and we're going to talk more about this in just a moment too, as Paul stated, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, who enables me, who empowers me to do just that. You know, it's easy to come here amongst God's children and be bold and be confident and give a testimony and praise God and shout and sing, whatever it is, and however form you want to do it. It's easy to do that in church, isn't it? But you know, it isn't so easy when you go out into that world, is it? That's when the pressure comes in on you. Oh, don't say anything. You don't want to, you might offend someone. You don't want to stand out. You don't want people to, you don't want to draw attention to yourself. Just, you know, let it go. Let it be, so to speak. I thank God would have us to be bold and to be confident when we get the opportunity to praise Jesus, to give Him honor and to give Him glory and to give Him the credit for all that's going on in our lives. But you sometimes you see, we won't do that, will we? No. We're afraid to. Fear overcomes us. We're too concerned about what people might say about us. We're too concerned about how it might appear to other people and what people might think of us. Well, that person, well, they're a Jesus freak. I'm a Jesus freak. I ain't ashamed to admit I'm a Jesus freak. I mean, my goodness, I would be nothing except for Jesus. He's my everything. Yeah. Everything that I do, everything that I've accomplished, everything I'm still doing, I give glory to Jesus because I couldn't do it apart from Him. There's nothing within me, about me, that would be able to do it. All credit, all glory I give unto my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That's why I am what I am and where I've got to where I'm at. And my friend, that's how I'm going to heaven one day. Because of Jesus, because of Him. Boldness, confidence. We're going to talk about some individuals this morning. Peter, to begin with, since this is the scripture, speaks to the fact that they saw his boldness. Now, Peter, some people by nature are more confident than others. They are. People are different. Peter was always bold, wasn't he? He was always confident. Did Peter make mistakes? He sure did. He sure did. Did he stick his foot in his mouth sometimes? He sure did.
Yeah.
But he didn't care to do what? Stand up and do it, did he? He did. He by nature was bold. He by nature was confident. That was his personality. But I'm going to tell you something too. Peter was a humble individual. He was humble. He was giving glory to Jesus, wasn't he? He was giving credit to Jesus in this particular situation. But they noticed his boldness. They noticed his confidence. And they said, you know something? They're unlearned and ignorant. That means they're uneducated. That's simply what they were saying. You know, they're just common, ordinary people, uneducated. And they marvel because they're so bold, they're so confident. But they said, now we believe we know why they are. They've been with Jesus. They've been with Jesus. You want confidence, you want boldness, then spend time with Jesus. Spend time with Him. He will enable you, He will empower you to be what He wants you to be. Now, by the world standards, they viewed Peter as being someone uneducated. They didn't view him as being someone who could be successful as a minister. As a preacher, so to speak. He was a fisherman by trade. He might have been a pretty good one. The Bible doesn't really say if he was good at it or not, but he made a living doing it. By choice. Well, you remember when God called him and some of the others said, look, I'm going to make you a fisher of men. I'm going to make you a fisher of men. Didn't have the credentials as we would speak of. He'd never been to any of the schools or anything like that. But God's plan for his life was for him to do what? And he had to go back and get him once again from his old occupation of fishing because he went back to doing it after Christ's resurrection. Was to feed his sheep. Peter, feed my sheep. 3 times he told that to him. That was God's plan for his life. And here's the thing about it. Christ gave him the power to be able to do what he did because that was God's plan for his life. He might have went on and, you know, made a living being a commercial fisherman, But he wouldn't have been happy. He never would have been happy because that's not what God wanted him to do. That's the important thing. Following God's will, God's plan for your life. No matter what the world may say about you, no matter what, how the world perceives you, they said, well, he's unlearned and ignorant. But he had Jesus on his side, didn't he? And it didn't bother him of this criticism. He was still going to be bold. He was still going to be confident because why? God had called him to do what he was going to do. He was confident by nature. Another individual who even his own brother, when you read the account of David, when he came to bring supplies to his brothers on the battlefield and the encounter with Goliath, even his own brother, from reading the scripture, I think believed him to be, well, you little cocky rascal. I know the pride of your heart. What do you come down here for anyway? Because I believe David was a confident person by nature. I really believe that he was. I think that's one of the qualities God used about him to elevate him from being a shepherd, because that wasn't God's plan for David's life to shepherd sheep all his life. His plan was for him to be what? The king of Israel one day. And this is a gigantic stepping stone toward that, wasn't it? When he came down and he saw all the armies of God cowering down to Goliath, afraid to even, go down and do battle with him. He had challenged them on more than one occasion. Send your best on down here and let's get this over with. If I defeat him, you be my servants. And if he defeats me, we'll be your servants. No one wanted any part of Goliath, did they? Nobody. Except David. You say, boy, he is a cocky little rascal, wasn't he? He wasn't even a man of war. And Saul even said to him, said, look, David, said, you're young. This man's been a man of war since his youth. You can't beat him. You ain't got a chance. David says, oh, let me tell you something. What God has enabled me to do, what God has done for me during my entire life. I've killed bears. I've killed lions. And he says, this uncircumcised Philistine will be no different. God will deliver him into my hands as well. I'll go fight him. Well, okay, but you better take this arm. You better take this sword. They said, I don't need that. I've never even tried. I don't have to use that stuff. I'll take what God has enabled me to be able to do and given me the talent to do. I'll take my sling down there. That's all he took. Think of this. Here's big, gigantic Goliath, almost 10 foot tall. He even had armor bearer in front of him. You and I couldn't carry the armor he had on. It's too heavy for you. I guarantee you could. Here comes the David. Goliath laughed at him. He thought that's funny. Well, he didn't laugh long, though, did he? When David planted one right between his eyes. Down he went. David ran, got his sword, cut his head off. Boldness. Confidence. In spite of what the situation may look like. Why? Because his confidence was in the Lord. He said, God will deliver him into my hands. God will give me the victory. This isn't my battle. This is the Lord's battle. And God delivered him, didn't he? God gave him the victory. Now, what about those who aren't so confident? Who have excuses. See, Peter and David, they offered no excuses. Peter didn't say, well, Lord, I'm not very educated. I'm unlearned and ignorant. No, it didn't stop Peter from standing up preaching, did it? David didn't say, Lord, I'm young. I've never been a soldier before. I don't know how to fight. It didn't stop David from going down that valley, did it? They were confident. They were bold, weren't they? But their confidence was in God and what he could do. Moses. He ran out from Egypt because he killed somebody, afraid of retribution. Ran off and shepherded sheep for 40 years. I guess he might have got pretty content with that lifestyle and just assumed that's the way I'm going to live out the rest of my life, shepherding sheep. And he was about 80 years old at this time. But no. That's not what God had planned for him. He appeared to him out of a burning bush and said, Moses, I've heard the cry of my people in Egypt. You are going down and bringing them out. You are going down and bringing them out. Now, realize this. God's grace and God's power can enable you to overcome your past and what you consider to be your inabilities if you put your faith and trust in Him. Because you see, I'm sure Moses said, well, I go back to Egypt. I killed somebody down there. My past won't let me go back and do that. And besides that, Lord, I can't even talk. Have a very bad, I can't communicate well. Doesn't say exactly, what the problem may have been. Maybe he stuttered. Maybe he couldn't pronounce his words well. Whatever the case may be, I can't communicate with people, Lord. And the Lord said, Moses, I'll be with you. Who made your mouth? You're the one I'm choosing. I didn't rescue you from a death when you were an infant and allow you to be raised in a royal family and then spend 40 years out here shepherding sheep. I was preparing you for this moment because this is what you're to do with your life. You need to embrace it with boldness and with confidence and go do it. It took some time, but he did. And this is the same man that God, now remember God was doing all this, but he chose Moses to be the vessel. Here's the man, the Red Sea parted. And we can talk about many other things that he was able to do through the power of God, that God did through him. Boldness and confidence. He wasn't too bold or confident now at the time that God called him, but he became that way, didn't he? Jeremiah. Many estimate probably around 20 years old when God appeared to him and said, look, Jeremiah. See, the thing about Jeremiah is this. He never married. He never even attended a wedding. He never attended anything that was joyful. That was God's plan and purpose for his life. He was the weeping prophet. He said, you've got a tough job, Jeremiah. You're going to go preach a message of doom to a people who are stiff-necked and hard-hearted. They're not going to listen to you. They're going to hate you for what you're doing. But I have called you, and I'll be with you. They won't even stand against you. Think of that. 20-year-old. Lord, I'm just a youth. I'm too young. And God said, don't say that. He said, Jeremiah, before you were even born, before you were even your mother, I knew you. I knew you before that. I'll be with you. I'll go with you. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I won't fail you. They can't prevail against you. Jeremiah developed the boldness and the confidence to do what many people wouldn't do. I'll guarantee you that. It's easy for me to stand up here and preach to you because, for the most part, you're believers, aren't you? Wouldn't be so easy if people were writing on me after service wanting to string me up somewhere, would it? That'd be a little different story, wouldn't it? They wouldn't be amen to me. They'd be booing me. And that's all the response he ever got from anybody. But he courageously and boldly and confidently did what? Continued to proclaim God's word to those people. With boldness and with confidence. In who? In the Lord. In the Lord. Paul. You talking about somebody overcoming a past. Many people say, well, I can't overcome my past. I'm going to tell you something, my friend. God's grace will enable you to overcome your past. Here's the greatest enemy the church had ever known. Stood and held their coats while they stoned Stephen to death. And God saved this man. He said, Paul, I've got plans for you. You're going to suffer for my name's sake. But you're going to carry the message throughout the world. I'm going to use you to write my word. You're going to do great things. I'm going to do great things through you. It's not going to be easy, but that's my plan for your life. Everywhere Paul went, they experienced a mini revival in that running out of town. Hated him. Hated him. Stoned him to the point where he didn't know if he was dead or not one time. Escaped miraculously several times from them until it was time for him to go home and be with the Lord. And he realized when that was. And he wrote his letter to 2 Timothy. But Paul remained bold and confident. It didn't matter who he's addressing. Kings. Didn't matter. He would boldly stand and proclaim, confidently proclaim the saving grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. And what I say to you this morning is this. You may be confident by nature, and that's fine. I mean, people are different. People are different. Some people are more confident than others. Some people are more bold than others. I mean, just different personalities, you know? But I want to say to you this morning, whatever it is that God wants you to do, you know, many people think, my dream is to be this, my dream is to be that. But here's the thing about it. It's what God wants you to do that's important. Because God's plan is greater and better than your dream. You may not think that it is, but it is. What does God plan for you to do? What does God want you to do? And I've made, you know, this statement before, and I'll say it again. Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians 4:13 is one of the most misused, taken out of context verses that you'll ever see in the Bible that people use. I can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth me. You talk about a verse that people selfishly take out of context and try to use that verse to justify what they want to do and what their dreams are. That's not what he's talking about. He wasn't talking about that. This man was writing this letter from prison. What he's speaking of, I can endure anything through Christ because he's strengthened me, because this is God's plan for me. This is what God wants me to do. But you see, so many people, they're pursuing their dreams, so to speak, what they want to do. Well, I can do it because Christ will give me the strength to do it. Let me tell you something. If it's not God's plan for your life, you're not going to get any strength from God to do it. You may go ahead and do it, but it's not going to be empowered by God to do it, because God has a plan for you. You need to check with him first. Before you start aspiring to certain dreams and what you think you want to do, you might ought to check with the one who created you first and what he would have you to do. And that's what Paul is talking about. He's not talking about, oh, I can do it because it's what I want and God's going to give me the strength to do it. I'll tell you one thing right now. There's been a lot of things in my life I wanted to do. I'm sure glad God didn't give me the strength to do those things, because they weren't God's plan. They weren't God's will for my life. God only empowers and gives you the strength to do what he wants you to do. You ought to be thankful for that. You ought to be grateful for that. Because if it hadn't been, you'd made a lot more of mistakes what you made right now. Been a lot worse shape off than what you are right now. You can do whatever it is God would have you to do. You may think, Moses, God, I can't do this. I just can't do this. But he did, though, didn't he? He did, didn't he? Jeremiah said, I'm too young. I can't do this. But he did, though, didn't he? You know why? Because that's what God wanted to do. He gave him the boldness and the confidence to do just that. You can overcome any obstacle, anything, if it's God's plan and God's will for your life. You can be confident in knowing that I can be and will be successful and prosperous because this is what God wants me to do. And if God be for me, who could be against me? I can't fail. I can't. Because it's God's plan. It's God's will. Christian, listen to me. Be bold. Be confident in what Jesus can do. Not in what you can do, but in what Jesus can do. Humbly realize it. all that we are, all that we accomplish, all that we can do, it's a result of what? God's power working in us. Give Him credit. Give Him glory for it. Always be humble in remembering that and realizing that. But my friend, be quick to have confidence and boldness in living for the Lord and doing what He would have you to do. Scriptures are filled with examples. Life is filled with examples of people just like Moses, David, Jeremiah, Peter, Paul, that God has called them from a life that they thought like that's what they were to be doing to a royal life. May not have been one filled with wealth. As a matter of fact, you remember what Peter said to the guy that was asking him what that he healed that was paralyzed? What did he ask him? He didn't come by asking to be healed. He said, I want money. Peter said, I ain't got no money. But what I have I given to you, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Rise up and walk. So you see, it's about praying, finding out, accepting what God wants you to be doing, and then going about it with confidence and with boldness. Unashamedly, for the whole world to see, this is what I am. This is who I am. I'm not putting on any airs. I'm not putting on any pretense. This is who I am. By the grace of God, I'm doing what God wants me to do. I'm lifting Him up. And that's what I'm going to do. That's what I'm going to do. Lift up Jesus with your life. Be confident in what He can do. He's able to do exceeding abundantly above all we're even able to ask or think of Him, is He not? Because He's God Almighty. There's no limits to His power. There's no limits to what He can do. We have limitations through our own power, through our own strength, do we not? We're unlimited through Jesus. Unlimited. That's why Paul said, I can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth me. And you can too. But be sure, it's God's plan. Be sure it's what God wants you to do. Because God has a plan for you. You may not be Jeremiah and have to do what he did. You may not be Moses and have to do what he did. But God has a purpose for you. God has a plan for you. Embrace it, and with boldness and with confidence, lift up Jesus to a lost and dying world. Because I'm going to tell you something. I can't save them. You can't save them. Church can't save them. Baptism can't save them. Observing the Lord's Supper can't save them. You can do all those things. Anybody can do those things. The only one that can save them is Jesus, because Jesus is the only one that can do what? Change their heart. You can do all the outward things. Anybody can do all the outward things. But that don't change the heart, does it? No, that doesn't change the heart. It may give the appearance of so, but no. Only Jesus can save. That's why He's the one we're to be lifting up. We're to be exalted. We're to be promoted. We're to be talking about. We're to be preaching about Jesus, His grace, His power, His sacrifice on Calvary's cross. Give all glory to Him. Paul stated, I am what I am by the grace of God. We all are, aren't we? It's by God's grace. His amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Jesus. No other name given among men whereby must be saved except the name of Jesus. Live your life for Jesus. You know, we as Christians should be a billboard for the Lord Jesus Christ, shouldn't we? We should be. We should be an advertisement for Him. His grace, His power, His strength. Be that in this lost and dying world. Be a billboard for Jesus. If you're here this morning, you don't know him as your personal Savior, he loves you. He wasn't ashamed of you. He died on that cross for your sins. Yours and mine. Unashamedly. Look to him in faith. Put your trust in him and what he did on Calvary's cross. Accept that for yourself. The penalty for your sin, his death, accomplished that. Put your faith in Jesus. Put your trust in Jesus. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, my friend. If anyone today hears this message, you don't know Jesus Christ, your personal Savior, I pray today will be the day you'd look to him. Believe. Trust in him. Accept God's grace and let God impart into you salvation. Let us pray.